fixed cost and the variable cost there. Now that the main impact will be the cost of fuel.
No. I'm saying two variables. Let's take energy and production volume. Do they go up and down with each other?
Yes. If production is low, then the consumption, the per unit consumption will be high, and that again will cost.
Now you take.
Now, the important thing is usually what we see is when the production goes up, the energy, total energy will definitely go up. Per unit may go up or may come down depending on the processing. When you interact with most of the people, they immediately correlate with each other. Why energy cost has gone up?
Because
production has gone up. Production has gone up, there is an energy. That may be true to some extent. But there are also possibilities that the production is not causing energy to go up or down. There may be something else which is impacting the energy cost.
But say that and break it down into smaller and smaller. This is a very important point you are making.
We'll show an example, but typical response of any manufacturing, right? I'm not blaming him, is the energy cost has gone up because my production has gone down. So my fixed equipments are still running, that's the reason. Specific energy consumption.
So stay with first point. He is saying a manufacturing head's response is as follows. If the energy cost has gone down, see, this is because of production coming down, because the fixed energy cost of the fixed equipment running is there. Correct? That is a natural response? Yes or no?
Yes. So?
No?
Yes.
Now, why? Most of the time, the production is causing energy cost to go up or down. True. But in that particular time, it may not be cause and effect. Just a correlation which is happening. There may be some other variable which is impacting the energy.
At that point in time.
Sometimes it happens because of selection of product.
So generalizing the correlation for any point in time may not be true of this.
Therefore, your mind, when you are taking the decision, has to have the rigor to say that they may optically be correlated but are not causal. That requires a thinking broad. Because the moment you start thinking deep on the same issue, you will justify yourself on every equipment, their energy efficiencies, and go down. You have not given yourself a chance to look at it differently. And therefore, you have in your mind solved the problem. But what have you solved? Something which probably doesn't exist. Kya bhari ho gaya?
So I'll give one more example. Most of the time, again, coming to energy, the response, what you probably is looking for your shifting channels. The energy cost is dependent on the weather,
on the
summer or the winter.
The weather. The ambient temperature,
summer.
Now, most of the cases, what happens is this response naturally comes.
So then, what is happening is, garmi mein kya hota hai, kam hota hai, zyada hota hai? Main bol gaya.
Garmi mein
kam hota hai, winter mein zyada hota hai.
There is a causation, I agree there is a causation because the ambient temperature has got an impact on it. But at that particular time, it may not be the one which is causing the energy cost.
Actually, we did a study, and Kiran did a study in a cement plant, Kotputli, and when he tracked the data in two seasons, to see that it is not creating the problem.
Study, in fact, the same thing. We show the energy cost is going up. Then the immediate response came was no, wo 3 mahine winter tha to isse le ja raha. So then we separated and tried to correlate and show there's no different.
Now if you get that response, you need to push back to the shift engineer, nahi to ye problem reh jata hai. then you have in your mind, what have you told yourself after hearing this? Ke jaade mein to jyada ho gayi. So a phenomena which may or may not exist, you have actually budgeted in to your planning system. So what are you doing? You are actually eroding value, right? Because that inefficiencies have been built into your cost model, to your cost of generation. Okay, will you click it? So these are those examples. Yeah. Now if you could read this. Now forget the, okay, I'll come to that. So when it says systemic changes, it says that the data moves in the same direction systemically. So when there is a change, there is a positive change in one variable, there is another change in the other variable also in the same direction. If it is a change in one variable positive, that is also positive. But they are not causing each other. So causality is more of a mathematical or a physical relationship. Forget the philosophical one, then it will go off in a tangent. It is also philosophical at times, but not relevant for you guys. It is mathematical or physical. Physical as in you can kind of attribute to it in the here and now in change of physical properties. Mathematical, you can figure out a mathematical relationship to demonstrate x1, x2, x3 have an impact on y, either a linear impact or a non-linear impact, where x1, x2 are independent variables. You remember when we learned maths in class, y equal to m1, x1 plus m2, x2 plus m3, x3 up till mn, xn, what are the x's and m's? X's are variables. What are the m's? Is constant plus c. M is the gradient, okay, the slope or the intercept. The point is x1, x2, x3 again are, could be what? Could be collinear or could be independent. Collinear is x1 may impact x2 also. X1 and x2 may be independent. All of them together, either through collinearity or through independence, impact y. Now, the low problem, ab ye y ho gaya boiler, correct? Boiler ke independent relationships hai sab ke saath, boiler efficiency. So, there will be m1, x1, m2, x2, anything, and k is a constant, either could be 0 or anything more than 0, which is the minimum condition. Now, x1 and x2 may be related, like pH is related to water quality. They influence each other, so they are not independent. So it runs through test of collinearity and then do a regression. Now, if you don't do any of that, at least know the x1s and x2s. Our experience has been people don't even know the x1s and x2s to the, so that they are collectively exhaustive. And then take a decision. The trade-off comes in situations where you have to say, this is my constraint and I can go either which way do I go so that my objective is maximized. Now, when we did say any of this, EBITDA max is not equal to cost mean, because the levers of the two equations are very different. So, within that, you would say, what are the constraints? Now, a constraint could be my factory cannot produce a particular grade beyond 10 hours, assume, because it is a specialty chemical, it needs a cleaning replenishment to happen. So, that becomes a constraint. Now, do I meet another grade for 15 hours versus this for 10 hours is a choice. A choice is a trade-off. You will have to say which trade-off is good for the problem called EBITDA max. Had the same problem been cost mean, I would come from the cost route. So the trade-off then would be 10 hours ki operating cost versus 15 hours ki operating cost, and the labor cost and the processing cost and the cleaning up cost and the startup cost, which one is most optimal?
What are you doing? So sometimes it happens with the customer satisfaction also. Say there is a particular product which will contribute less to the EBITDA. But since we have to capture the market, will be.
Those are strategic choices. We are talking optimizations. So then don't mix up those. Those are decisions taken at a different level. That is also a trade-off where EBITDA max is not the problem. Future EBITDA is the problem. Now look at causality. Read the causality definition. Something causes something else if there is a chain of events between the first and second thing, each other, which causes next thing in the chain to happen. Look at that. A causality is a chain of events or a chain of happenings. Yeah,
so what it says is, let's say, if my water treatment plant operation is not proper, my pH gets affected, my water quality gets affected. As the water efficiency comes down. So it's a chain of events.
Now, if I mess up my pH, it has an impact. Now, the leadership question to ask is, which is the peritu now in all of this? मैंने आई में पी एच में भी काम करूँ, मैं फ्यूल एयर में भी काम करूँ, कितना लोगों के साथ मेरे को बात करना पड़ेगा, तो काम ही चालू नहीं होगा ना. There are two kinds of people. Either they work at the lowest end of the chain, not knowing what it impacts, or the other people who are in complexity paralysis. They will say, तो कुछ ही नहीं करता हूँ मैं, but it is good. Okay. Let's move. What time is it now? No. Yeah. What are the laws, huh? We remember principle 2. Now, principle 2 is actually, to beat principle 2, you will have to work across functions. And working across functions, you will have to understand value drivers to understand what to talk to functions. Now, imagine the same boiler efficiency. We saw that there is a procurement function, there is an operations function, there is a maintenance function. Right? Now, you as a unit head, you are doing anyway maintenance review. What are the questions you are asking maintenance? Stores and spare part inventory, replenishable stores, new capex stores, insurance stores. You ask the same questions every review, he gives you the same answers. Then what is the question you ask? Budget versus actual. Then he will say, my maintenance crew has gone up because my contractable cost has grown up, and therefore because we don't have automation, I am doing maintenance through these kind of gangs. So that is the conversation. Khatam, maintenance chala gaya. Then there will come the procurement guy. You will say, okay, he will tell you how difficult it is to get coal because import coal is too expensive. Then there will be the fuel services agreement if he has one. He will say that I have this, so this is what I am getting from Singareni coal field. The third level he will tell you, then I am so brilliant that I am getting you the best coal at the e-auction, but the operations guy always wants the best coal and therefore it is not possible to get and we save so much money. You as a unit is very good, goes back. Ab kaun bacha? Procurement operations head gaya. Operations head then will come, which is technical head. He will tell the unit head, Baba, how difficult it is to run the plant, how the equipment are low, how he is trying to improve OEE, and then it is gone. Third conversation gone. Now what happens to boiler efficiency? Now if you were to do a boiler efficiency review, he say, I will only review boiler efficiency in the context of calorific value, the impact on water cost, the auxiliary auxiliary equipment performance, and I will synchronize the review so you aptards don't talk about anything else. Then what are you doing as a unit head? In the previous context, previous conversation, you were doing a deep conversation. You are going down one function deep down. Here you have got three conversations, you are doing a broad conversation. I am not saying do either or. do a combination. If you don't do a combination, then what happens? At the intersection of functions, what are these three functions in one boiler efficiency? If we had time, we are doing a master class, we would have actually made you draw all the maps. And then you see how many conversations you miss. And what is the monthly reporting format? They are the same things you give in planning and budgeting, the same things you break it into quarterly, same things you break it monthly, and the same conversations, you have the same responses you go. So the value is the same, you have created value. Because the processes are creating value any which way, then might as well, then the human intervention or superior manufacturing professional never evolves. He is just an administrator of doing the same conversations. So the power is not on your understanding of technology. Nobody really cares how much you know Mendeleev's periodic law, a table, or do you know PVNRT and how it manifests into pressure as you grow. The differentiating competencies is how you collaborate, engage across functions around these specific intervention points. Because the others will do that. They will know heat balance, mass balance. Now, if they are doing heat balance, mass balance, you are doing heat balance, mass balance, then one of the jobs are suboptimal. Now, if the shift engineer is worried about TPH, the section in charge is worried about TPH, the function head is worried about TPH, the unit is talking TPH, then we don't need so many people, no? Then what party says, who is going to do the integration of system, process and people? Because nobody's trained you to do it, right? You are most comfortable, you know mal. So TPH. At best you know uptime. What is uptime? Total available hours minus and you will sandbag it. Cement mein bolta hai, if it is a refractory big chain, 17 days. You will do it in 13 days and still say FR exceed expectation. ठीक है इसका निष्कर्ष क्या है चाय कॉफी पीना है कुछ
नॉट डूइंग
वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इज द मैप एंड गेट द वैल्यू
करेक्ट सिंपल
कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ
आई लव यू I just absolutely love you with great gravitas. You tell me back what I told you. Haan, boli.
No, that's what I want to tell. Combination of vertical thinking and horizontal thinking.
No, you have to practice it. No, so yeah. You get it. Tell them to practice it. Unless they practice it, there's all this thing. Bahut gyan vaj chalega. So you have to reconfigure this problem that you did. So all that you have learned. And if it is not different, I will resign.
Yeah.
And if it is different, then what happens?
Maybe not resign.
Oh God, Nana Gupta ji, it's a joke. Okay.
In this case, we said that our objective is boiler efficiency. There are multiple functions impacting the boiler efficiency. So what you are trying to do, you are trying to improve the boiler efficiency. Now just see the larger picture. Instead of boiler efficiency, now your objective is the power cost. Right? Now it may happen that you sacrifice on boiler efficiency, but still get a better power cost by purchasing a lower
cost,
lower price. Possible, right?
Possible.
So the entire thing changes. Typically what happens? You try to push forward.
Reduce the
length of the point. Awesome. I just gave one.
That is again a trade-off.
It's again a trade-off.
It is a very, you talk about trade-off, that is an equipment life trade-off to operation cost trade-off. Depending upon the existing life remaining, the terminal value of the equipment, you will make the trade-off. Barab. That is
the trade-off. In the unit head, you have to decide whether shall I sacrifice this boiler efficiency, shall I go ahead.
And because the point is, when you become a unit head, no, you will not be able to think like this. So you can do it only at your age. I mean, practically. Because once you have become a unit head by chance, then you just cannot think like this. Your ability to change is very low.
But with these threats only you are liable.
You have to build it while you are, actually you should build it at department head level, shift engineer level if I had my way. But when you are already united.
Yes, something has to be
built
systematically approached.
As a child, career.
Molded, you can mold it.
It's
mold
a man to become a practice. Naturally.
But normally, it should be done. Because of these traits, because of these practices, that person must have become a.
Not causal, it is might be correlated.
Right, so most of the topics which we are discussing is only the part of meetings, you know, high KPIs, everything we are discussing those high KPIs.
Karte jao, maja aata hai na.
And honestly speaking, even unit heads are also discussing those high KPIs only.
Correct. So you are in actually in absolute coalition with them. You are good, they are good, so everybody is good. But you know, you see. Nobody is really a manufacturing leader. Now the question is, forget the unit head, whoever they may be. The question is, do you want to change and develop using a different framework? You have time to do it.
Yes.
It requires conscious practice, it's just not.
Yeah.
Because the problem is, the moment you are out of the workshop, you go into the real world, then it's a bhul jaoge. I know.